Good afternoon, everybody. Hope you had a great weekend. I am back in the lab and hoping that we can finish up our testing with electroporation so we can move on with the process of engineering fungal cells using agrobacteria. And so, yeah, I was doing a little bit of reading on electroporation, and apparently the technology dates back to the 18th century. Scientists would apply a small electrical voltage to animal and human skin cells, and they noticed that they would turn red. And from there, they just kept investigating and investigating. Eventually, it was used to modify the embryos of chickens. And so it actually goes way, way back. But in terms of like modern molecular biology and the use of electroporation, 60s and 70s really took off. And then 80s and 90s, it sort of became a staple for doing genetic transformation. So yeah, today we are going to go ahead and see if we can take our electroporation learning to the next level by introducing some DNA into it. So far, we've been doing a lot of testing with just the bacterial cells and no DNA. But today we're actually going to use the Spanish plasmid, which I'm going to take all the way through agrobacteria and into the fungi. We're going to try and see if we can transform some E. coli with the Spanish plasmid. And if you followed a lot of my other posts and videos, you'll see that the Spanish plasmid, which is, here's a plasmid map for it. This was actually given to me as a gift by a professor in Spain. So that's why I call it the Spanish plasmid, not the actual formal plasmid name. But it's really interesting plasmid because it contains the an enhanced GFP gene, and then it has a hygromycin resistance of HPH. Hygromycin resistance gene as well, so we can do selection on our fungus, which has been transformed. And this is a binary plasmid, which I've covered in, you know, some of my other videos. So it actually works in E. coli, agrobacteria, and then in fungi as well. But yeah, we're gonna go ahead today and see if we can't add some of that Spanish plasmid to some E. coli cells, run them using the electroporation, and hopefully we get some successful transformance. If we do, then I would say we've done a really good job of starting from the beginning and just bringing you through the journey of how we learn a new tool, and a very valuable tool as well. This is a pretty cool machine, although this one's old. It's from like probably the 90s, and I got it from eBay. But if we can master this with E. coli and all of this, get this good practice in, then we can start to move on to the agrobacteria. And there's a lot of steps involved in prepping for that, but at least I'll have the confidence to buy the agrobacteria and put it through the same process because it's identical. The process is identical. Even the settings, the voltage, and all these other things are pretty much identical. So all of this is not only teaching me a tool, but it's giving me practice to use the agrobacteria. So for today though, what we need to do is the Spanish plasmid has a kanamycin resistance gene in it for selection in E. coli. So of course we'll need to prepare some plates that have kanamycin spread across the top. And then we'll also need to prepare a fresh lawn of the DH5 alpha bacteria. So let me go ahead and get set up for that and take care of that. And then I'll connect with you in a few hours once the DH5 alpha has formed. It takes about 4 to 6 hours. And then we'll run our experimentation. And depending on, I don't know yet if I want to wait for this video to reveal the results or do it in another one. We'll probably do it in a follow-up video because it can take a day and a half to see the transformance. But we'll go ahead and run the experiment. And if all goes well, what we'll be looking for today is for there to be no arcing as usual, no popping as you kind of saw in a previous video, and a good time constant here. And we haven't really talked much about the time constant and how that relates to success, but there's some formulas involved with applying the voltage over particular capacitance and resistance, and it gives you a time constant for, you know, basically how long the voltage was applied to the cells. And we're looking for 5 milliseconds, but anything close to that is acceptable. So let me go ahead and get set up, do the preparation, and then I'll check back with you guys on the other side. I'd like to talk about that I haven't mentioned a whole lot lately, and that is controls. Controls are really important to science and the scientific process, but especially in genetic engineering where there's so many different variables that could cause your experiments to behave unexpectedly or to give you false positives. And the false positives can be equally detrimental to your research and also to your psychology, because this is hard work. And so I use the successes to give me fuel to keep going. And if I find that I build upon a success that wasn't real, then it just creates, it accumulates, and it creates more problems down the road. One of the things that I want to talk about in particular is the plasmid itself. This plasmid, the Spanish plasmid, was sent to me through the mail, blotted on a piece of filter paper, and then I used the heat shock transformation to put the plasmid into some E. coli, and then I used a mini prep kit to filter this plasmid out. But I don't have a lot of fancy machinery that can help me quantify how much of the plasmid is in there, and I haven't sent that plasmid out to the lab to get fully sequenced. So I don't know if maybe that plasmid was mutated when it was in one of the E. coli colonies that I used to grow it out and filter it out. So there's a lot of things about that particular plasmid that could have gone wrong and could cause some issues down the road with the these tests that we've been doing in the with electroporation. And so, yeah, we could, the other variable is kanamycin. My kanamycin could go bad, or your antibiotic for selection can go bad. And if that happens, then you'll get colonies growing after you run your electroporation experiments, but they weren't actually transformed. They're growing because the antibiotic didn't really work. So that's an example of where you could get a false positive. So controls are really important. You're going to see them mentioned in every paper. And just because I don't necessarily talk about them doesn't mean that they aren't important and they aren't something that you should do. If you are doing research so that you can publish, that research should definitely include some controls, and you should include the results of those in the paper that you write or in whatever work you decide to publish. I will say, though, as being a DIYer and working in a home lab here, there's trade-offs with doing controls. It's more cost, more materials, more time. And so as you gain more experience, you begin to learn when you can make those trade-offs. And sometimes you take calculated risks to save on those time and materials costs so that you can keep moving forward. But having controls has just been a lifesaver for a lot of different things when it comes to failures. The failures give you, the controls are sort of a way of debugging, just taking some terminology from the computer science world. The controls give you a chance to kind of inspect what you're doing and debug and step through your work and make sure that you've covered all your bases. So that's a little bit about controls. They're really important and it's something for you to keep in mind. Electrocompetent cells here. I'm going to go ahead and prepare the area for DNA and for doing the electroporation. The first thing I'm going to do is just to clear up some space is I'm going to take and put in the recovery media into the two test tubes that we're going to do. And I'm going to put 500 microliters of fresh LB broth into each one. Okay, I have now put in my recovery medium into here, and then I have 40 microliters of the bacterial suspension in each one of these tubes, the test tubes. The next thing we're gonna do is add the Spanish plasmid DNA, which looks like this. So this is roughly a 9,000 kilobase pair plasmid that works in agrobacteria, has fungi promoters and terminators, an enhanced green fluorescent protein, and a hygromycin resistance gene. And we're gonna take 1 microliter and we're gonna put that into each one of these test tubes that we're gonna be electroporating. So let's do that now. Okay, and finally, the next thing we need to do is now that we have our DNA bacteria mix here, is go ahead and put these in the cuvettes and then fire them and hopefully we get good readings. And if they do, we'll go ahead and recover these in these tubes here for about an hour in the incubator, and then I'll plate them on the plates that I made that have the antibiotic for selection. All right, we are now ready to run this test here. First one with the Spanish plasmid DNA. Okay, let's set the volts. And let's go ahead and run it. Okay, well that one did not work. We saw the spark. Let's try another one. Take number 2. Hey, that one worked. Let's go ahead and recover. Move this over so you can see. So I'm gonna take the cap off. Micropipetter. Take this fresh LB and mix that into here. There we have it. So I'm gonna pop this in the incubator and let it recover for an hour, and then we'll go ahead and plate it and see how everything went. All right, since we have extra cells and I have some time and I have 2 extra cuvettes, I went ahead and prepared 2 more aliquots of the bacterial suspension and DNA mix. And we'll go ahead and run those on the last 2 cuvettes now. See how this goes. Excellent, 4.6. Bring that over here. This is kind of what recovery looks like, is using this micropipetter to put some media into the cuvette and then sucking it right back out. Now we'll prepare the second one. Okay, here we go. Oh. Shoot, that one didn't work. 0.6. All right, interesting. All right, since we're here and I already have all the materials out, I figured why don't I open up a new cuvette and we'll just do one more. So let's give it a go. All right. Time constant, 4.6. Woo! So we've had two pops and two successes. So 50% success rate today with the DNA. Let me put those in the incubator for an hour, then we'll plate them, and then we'll cross our fingers and pray to the biotech gods that there was some successful transformations with the Spanish plasmid. And then we will check the plates to make sure that it worked. By the way, if you're wondering how I sterilize these cuvettes between uses, I put them in a little bit of bleach water for about 10 minutes or so, and then I rinse them with deionized water, and then I let them dry in front of the flow hood. Right, it's been a little over an hour. Let's go ahead and remove these recovery tubes and bring them over to the lab, and we'll go ahead and get them plated on our kanamycin selection plates. Topic of controls, I think what I'm going to go ahead and do is just take a plate that doesn't have any antibiotic on it, and I'm going to split it three ways like this. And I have three tubes here, so I'm going to go three, they're labeled, two, three, and four. And then what I'm gonna do is just take a little bit from each one and drop it into each section. And this will at least tell me that after electroporation, there were living cells that were successfully recovered. And even if I don't get any transformance, at least I know my cells lived. And that kind of rules out a variable in the process. So let me go ahead and get these put onto here. And I'm not gonna streak them or anything like that because I just wanna make sure that they grow. So I'm just gonna drop them into each of these sections and maybe use the pipette tip to just move it around a little bit. So let me do that now. All right, I have plated my controls. Now what I'm going to do is place them on a flat surface and let them soak in for probably 10 minutes or so, and then we'll bring them right over into the incubator. And we should get some results in the next 24 to 48 hours. We'll keep you posted. See you guys next time.